Here I talk about coroutines that will come with C++20, and no, this is not a time travel, this is just a typo. Sorry about that. And yeah, I did it. So I will talk about coroutines here and what there might be special for small embedded systems. So I have a first part about coroutines and a second part about the small embedded systems. So where do we actually find information about coroutines? So of course you can look at the standards, so the latest draft, which is more or less what will probably be published. Well, no, it still will contain some fixes, but I don't think anything in the coroutine part. So you can look that up on the internet. Then we actually had the technical specification published, which you can also look up at the internet. But that is, yeah, it doesn't make such a lot of sense to look at that one. However, looking at the original proposal, well, the one in 2014 was not exactly the first one, but that's the one that actually more or less pretty closely resembles what we have now, and it also has all the motivation in it, why you actually want to have coroutines. So that might actually be useful. However, you can actually make it much easier. Go to Lewis Baker's blog. Well, he only published three blog posts all about coroutines, and they are actually very helpful to understand how this actually works. And so my knowledge partly comes from there and partly from the original papers, but yeah, I haven't really worked in Angel with coroutines, so there are still quite a lot of things that I don't have internalized yet. So you can always ask questions, but that doesn't mean that I know the answer. So why would you actually want to have coroutines? So this is a typical example. So yesterday we had a talk about callbacks and benchmarking callbacks. And so you can of course work with callbacks. So you have an asynchronous read. Yesterday it was about the UART. This time it's about the internet or just any TCP socket. And so you want to read some data, and then you give it a callback what to do when the data arrives. And so this is the original start one. And then the callback, when the data actually arrives, that now has to do something with that data. And this actually decides, okay, it writes it back to the same socket. And when that is done, again, we have a callback. And so this was the read one. And in the write, actually, when the write is done, we start reading again. So now the actual logic is distributed over three different functions. If you do that with coroutines, you actually have one single function. So you set up your socket, you set up your buffer, and then you co-await the read. And this co-await actually tells the compiler, okay, at this point in the function, I actually stop executing the function right now, I suspend the function, and now I immediately return from this function. And there's a lot of mechanics behind that, and I will show that in the next slides. But at this point, it actually suspends. Now, when the data actually is ready at the time where previously the callback would be called. Now the function is resumed, and now it actually continues at the next line. So the next line actually is the co-await write. So again, it returns back to whoever resumed that function, and now it started the write, and whenever it comes back, then it comes back, and now you go back to the start of your loop, and you just loop. So I would say it's much easier to understand this code than this code. Now, if you look closely at this thing here, you have an endless loop. And this is actually what you have quite often in coroutines. Coroutines very often don't run to the end, never run to the end. But I will come back to that later as well. So this is just one motivation. My example is actually a different one. So I actually had a talk here last year about executors, and they actually showed how to do this with stackless coroutines, with stackful coroutines partly. But the example is essentially still the same. So you actually have something. You have two different providers who actually read data from some device. So you have a read one, which writes data into a queue, and you have another read function that also writes data into the queue, and then you have something that consumes that data, and in my case, it's just a simple log function. So this is essentially the example I will show. So all this, so these reads are actually blocking things, asynchronous operations. So whenever some data is ready, they will be resumed and will write data into the queue, and that will actually trigger the logging, and that will, in my case, just write it to C-log. So this example I will show here. So let's look at it. So here's one of the producers. The other is exactly the same. It just only writes a 2 here instead of a 1. And so because for examples, it's pretty hard to really provide something that provides data, especially if you want to have some latency. And so I actually decided to have a timer here instead of real data, but this is just for the demo. So the first thing I do inside of my reader is I create my timer. And it has a strange name, timer awaitable, and that has a reason. And so this is essentially my timer. I start that. And then again, I have my endless loop. And the first thing I do is I do a co-await on my timer awaitable. So this actually suspends my function, and it immediately returns. And however, what it also does, it actually registers for waiting whenever data is available, so whenever the timer actually fires. And if that fires, this function, this coroutine, will be resumed. So now, and the data I get that was actually read. I get that in here, so it's just 64 bits. And then I create some data item to push into the queue. And this again is a co-await, because in my case, this is an asynchronous function, because my queue is actually a push-driven queue. So whenever something is pushed into that, this will actually trigger this logger, this consumer down here, and that will actually print it. And if that's finished, then the push will resume, and then I go back in my loop. So here I have two co-awaits, one for waiting for the data, and the other one is for the push into the queue. And my consumer, my log function, that also enters the endless loop. In this case, it's actually not really an endless loop. Well, yeah, it's still some kind of an endless loop. So the point is, the first thing I do is a co-await again on my queue. So I want to pull something out of the queue. And so, of course, I suspend immediately because there's no data in the queue. But later, if there is data in the queue, I will get resumed. I will print something, and I will actually stop everything after the first 10 items. However, I just call the stop, but I still enter my endless loop again. So I will not drop out of my coroutine. Never. And now, putting everything together, I first create my queue, then I start one reader, then I start the other reader, and then I start the consumer, and then I actually start my loop that drives everything. And if that loop ends, then my program ends. And this is not a coroutine. Main can never be a coroutine. So, what does actually happen behind the scene? So, what I do is I call the read1 function, and if you look back, so I actually have my call stack, and I will write it from bottom up. So I have my initial stack frame for the main, and then I call my read1 function. So I, and then the call is just a normal call, essentially. So actually what happens is I enter this function, and now all the data that would go into the stack frame of this function, that doesn't go to the stack frame, it goes to a special coroutine frame. So we have a coroutine frame for my read1, and that has all the data that is required to inside the function, essentially. So it has the parameter, which is just a reference to my queue. It has the timer. And it has the local variables inside of the loop. So it's my dummy and my val. So I have the timer here. Timer, I have the data, I have the value, and what I also have is I have my program counter. Because whenever I want to go back to my function, I need to know at which point inside of the function I have to continue. So that's my program counter. And however, so I actually create this timer. I don't really create the dummy yet and the value, because before I actually create the dummy, I do a co-await. And at this point, the function returns. So I don't have this stack frame anymore. I still keep this coroutine frame. But I don't have the stack frame anymore. Instead, I return to my main function, and then I actually call read2. So I have another function, which does exactly the same. So this is my read1, and this is my read2, where I have the same data as up here. And then the same happens. I do a correlate inside of my read2, and now I return again to my main. Now inside of my main, now I call the log function. So this is not the read anymore, it's now the log, which is the consumer. And here, again, it's a coroutine, so a coroutine frame will be created for it. And inside of that, I will have my count and my V, and again, the program counter. And after that, this is, and then, no, at the pull call, so at the correlate, again, I leave my function. So now I'm actually going back to my main function. So this is the main. So the next thing I actually do is the loop. And now I go inside my loop, and now I actually do everything. So now I have my small current stack, and I have, for all the coroutines that I have started, I have my coroutine frames. So this is the start. So this again is the control flow that I just showed here. And now this is exactly what stackless coroutines means. We only have one single stack. We don't have a stack for each coroutine. We only have a single coroutine frame and nothing else. So whenever I resume a coroutine, I use the one single stack that I have. So again, a stackless coroutine doesn't have a full stack, and they just use a normal stack, and they have their special coroutine frame. And this coroutine frame has a type that is provided by the compiler. It's called std coroutine handle, and that is just a handle. It's essentially just a pointer to my coroutine frame. But I can use this to resume, for example, a coroutine. So now, for my coevaluate, I actually need a so-called evatable type. So whenever I do a coevaluate, I give it an expression, and that the type of that expression must be an evatable. And now what the compiler actually creates for this coevaluate is, inside of my evatable, I must have some member functions. So it actually first calls the member function evate ready, and that can just check whether it actually needs to suspend or whether it can just continue. So typically it will suspend, so it typically will return false. And so now the next thing is actually it will suspend the coroutine. So after this, the coroutine is actually in a suspended state, which means From this point, it could be resumed. However, it is not suspended at this point. It's actually suspended at this point. So whenever it's resumed, it will resume at this point. So the program counter inside of the coroutine frame, this will point to this point in the program. However, before I actually return from my function, because whenever I do a coroutine, I return from my function. So before I actually return from my function, another function is called inside of my available, and that is generally the most interesting function, because here I actually first get the coroutine frame, so the coroutine handle, so I can actually store that somewhere, so that can be used for assumption, and now I can actually start my asynchronous operation, typically inside of the operating system. And then it actually, after this, it returns to the caller. This could actually return a Boolean, and if it returns false, then it will not actually suspend, but it will immediately continue here, so it will not suspend the coroutine, but just continue normally. And then, whenever this coroutine is resumed, then await resume is called on my available. And this actually provides the value that I co-await for, which could be void when I just wait. However, it could also, for my pull case, so here I actually get data. So this data here, that is provided by the await resume function. So that has the logic inside to provide the data. So again, an awaitable is a type that must have at least three member functions. The await ready, that is just okay. May I want to suspend or just continue immediately anyway? And then the await suspend. And again, this one gets the handle to the coroutine frame for resumption later. And this one typically starts any asynchronous operation. And then the resume function, the await resume function, that has to provide the value if I actually need a value from co-await. So let's look how I actually implemented my queue, because that actually has two different awaiters. However, the normal interface from a queue, well, that is just push and pull. So inside of my push, I get a value, and I store that value inside of my queue. My queue can only store one single value, because it's a cooperative queue, so it can only ever store one single value, and whenever it gets a value, it has to call whoever wants to read that value. So now I need to know who is waiting for the value, and that is my consumer. That consumer is just a coroutine handle. So I need to store, whenever I call pull, I need to store this consumer, and so whenever I do a push, I actually need to resume my consumer. And this is how this specific queue works, and so it's actually a push-driven queue. So whenever I push something into it, I push that value down to the consumer, and I reactivate that consumer. Others actually prefer a pull-based queue, which essentially just says, okay, whenever I want to pull a value out of it, then I start a producer. This doesn't work in my case because I actually have two different producers, so I wouldn't know which one to start. So in my case, I really want to have a push-driven queue. So in this case, I only have a consumer here. And then I have a Boolean flag. I wouldn't actually need that, but it makes life a little bit easier. And now, based on this, my push function actually stores the data. It sets my flag of true. And now I return my available. And now inside of my available, because it's an available, I have my function await ready, await suspend, and await resume. So whenever I do a co-await push, this will call on the available my await ready. Now, if I don't have any consumer, it doesn't make sense to block because I don't have anybody who is interested in that value. So that means I immediately return. And for my push, I don't return anything. So my await resume just does nothing. However, if I have a consumer, I return false from here. So the next thing it actually does, it calls the, well, it suspends my coroutine. And now it calls await suspend. And now I actually start my consumer. I wouldn't need that check here because I have done that check already up there. But just for demo purposes, I have it still here. So here I actually call or resume my consumer. So my consumer is the log function that actually tries to get a value. It is currently suspended on the pull function. Now I actually resume that log function at the pull point, and then that gets a value, and I resume that function. And if that function actually returns, then I come back here, and then I come back later. Let's look at that a little bit later. I always get a little bit confused about the controls about the control flow when I have multiple coroutines going on, but I actually have that a little bit later. So, but the point is the push evader, it actually suspends the current coroutine and it resumes the consumer coroutine. Now, on the other side, I have my pull evader. So my pull evader, that also has the full interface. And so that actually checks whether my queue is full, whether I actually have data. But because I don't have data available, it doesn't make sense to actually suspend. And now the next thing is I suspend. Well, I just store myself, my own coroutine handle, inside of the consumer so the producer knows who to assume. And now if I actually push something somewhere, now the I get resumed, so my resume function is called. And so I actually return the data that is currently stored in the queue. And now my log function gets the data, does something with that, and then it does correlate again, and then it will get suspended again, which will again store this coroutine handle. So I will store this coroutine handle whenever I get suspended. Questions so far?
Yeah. At the beginning, you said that coroutines never end. So you always have that infinite while loop. Why is that? Why wouldn't you be able to end it?
The point is, this is not always the case. That is a typical case. But you can also end your coroutines if you want, and you have co-return and co-yield for that, and or you can just reach the end of your coroutine. So that is possible also, and I will come back to that a little bit later. Yeah?
Once a coroutine is resumed, is the coroutine frame copied on top of the stack?
No.
Okay.
The coroutine is just specially compiled, so it doesn't look at the stack, it just looks at the coroutine frame.
Okay, yes.
Other questions so far? Okay, so let's look at another part of my program, because that is a loop. So this is what drives everything, and that actually internally uses the epoll from the Linux kernel, and this actually has nothing to do really with any coroutine at all. It's just a little bit system programming, so I will not go into much detail of that. The only interesting part is I have an add function, so I can actually add my timer to my epoll events that I'm waiting on. So this is what I do here. And I have a mechanism that I can stop everything. This is what I do in my log function when I have got 10 data values. And the only thing I store inside is the file descriptor for my epoll and my flag and nothing else. And then the actual loop that just does the epoll wait. So it's a system call, it's a blocking system call. And one thing that I forgot to mention is inside of my event that I actually store, I can store some pointer. The typical system interface, so I store a void pointer. And so I actually store a pointer to my awaitable. So I actually need to get that awaitable as an argument. So I actually store this awaitable, a pointer to this awaitable inside of my loop. And so inside, inside of the event, so inside of my loop, in my epoll wait, well, whenever that returns, I get an event. I get only one single event, but because I say so, I only want one. And inside of that, I have this data pointer. And so I just static cast that back to my epoll awaitable. And in my demo, I don't need a std function, but because I know it must be a timer. It's always the same. So I actually do a static cast to this one, and then I call the handle await on my timer object. So I do nothing special, coroutine special inside here. I just want to show, okay, what I actually do to call out to the system inside of my coroutines. So what I actually do is I call the handle event. So this is now the timer implementation So the first, the constructor just constructs my timer, starts it, and then it calls the add function on my epoll event loop. And then on the handle event, whenever that is called, here I actually read my data. So for a real reader from some socket or something like that, here I would actually read my data. And now I resume myself because I'm an available. And so I actually store a handle to my own coroutine inside of my available. So I can resume this available. So I can resume the coroutine and so this way it actually gets started again. So in this case it would be my reader that now gets out of the co-await read, and now it can go to the co-await push. And so the only other things I store inside of my class is the current value that I give here and the file descriptor. And I call myself timer available, so I have to provide the full available interface, and that is actually on the next slide. So in my await ready, I just always return false. I really want to block and want to resumed by the loop. And inside of my suspend, I just store the coroutine handle inside my class object. And here is where I would typically start the read, the asynchronous read. Now, in my case, I actually started the timer up front in my constructor, and it's an interval timer, so it will come again and again, so I don't need to restart that. So I actually do nothing here, and then I just return true. So as I have said before, you can either return void, then it will always suspend, or you can actually say whether you want to suspend or you don't want to suspend. If you, after you started your asynchronous operation, you already know that now you have a value, so it doesn't make sense to suspend, then you can return false here, and then you wouldn't actually suspend. But in my case, I always return true here, so that's fine. And now, whenever I get resumed by my handle event function, now I return the value that I co-await on. And that's essentially it. So let's look again how the control flow continues. So right now we have the main function and that called the loop function, and we have our coroutine frames. Now I'm inside of my loop, so I call my epoll wait, and now that returns, and now I call the handle event function. So here I call my handle event function. And this handle event function, that actually resumes one of these readers, depending on which one actually returned or got a timer event. So here I actually put that on my stack as well, because I resumed that function. So whenever I resume a function, I go back to my stack and call a function more or less normally. So actually, this is my read whatever. And now I resume at the program counter that was stored here. and now I do whatever I do inside here. Well, what I actually do inside of my read function, let's look at the actual code. So what I do inside my read function, so this one now got resumed. So I actually got a value out of my resume, and now the next thing I do is I do the coavait push. Because it's a coavait, I actually suspend myself. Well, the very first thing is it calls await ready, but because that returns false, I actually suspend myself, so I don't have this one anymore. But I call inside of the evader that comes out from my push here, inside of that evader, this is the evader from the push, so we can actually look at the queue, and so the push evader, this actually resumes the consumer. It resumes the log function. So now I don't have this one anymore, but now I have my log stack frame here. Because I resume that function, that goes to my normal stack. And now this log function, if we go back here, so this one returned, it got a value, it writes out that value. We are not at 10 yet, so we continue our endless loop, and now I do a pull again. So now I do a coavait pull again, so I suspend my coroutine, and because inside of the suspend of the queue, I just call this one, but don't do anything else, so I don't resume anybody else, so I just suspend this one, and I come back to my handle event. And now, because my handle event essentially just is a loop itself, this is a timer. So here, my handle event, it resumed that one, but now I return from that one because I suspended, so I return to this handle event, and so I return from my handle event, so this one goes from the stack as well, and I'm back inside of my loop. And now inside of my loop, I so this one here returned, so I just go back here. And then everything starts again. So this is how the coroutines actually work. So you can actually resume them using the function call operator on the resume function. And then whenever you do a coavait again, then you suspend again. And that's all. So again, any questions so far? Okay. So now let's look at the second part of my title, the small embedded systems. So Now, where does the memory here actually comes from? Well, if you call a coroutine from the call side inside of my main, well, calling that function is nothing special. It just calls that function. However, that function is compiled very specially. Because first, instead of going to the stack pointer, it has to go to the coroutine frame. And second, it has to return a special type, which is a promise type. And that actually can be used for customize some of the things. And so actually, if my function read1 is initially called inside of main, well, then essentially this happens. So the very first it does, it allocates a new coroutine frame using normally the global new operator. So here it actually calls allocates heap memory. And then it creates my promise type, and it gets the return object because my read function actually returns a specific type, a specific value. And it needs to get that value, and it gets that value from my promise type. And then it does an initial suspend. It calls an initial suspend, which in my case always, it actually co-evades that. So this has to return an evader. However, in my implementation, that actually returns a special evader, suspend never, so it doesn't suspend. And now it actually starts to execute the coroutine body, in my case, until it reaches the first co-evade. And now when it reaches that first co-evade, then it will return this object here that came from get return object. And so the interesting functions here, well, actually the only really interesting function here is the get return object, because that has to provide the initial return object from the first call of my coroutine, which needs to be some kind of promise type. And then there are some others, and so the final suspend, for example, that is called whenever you actually end your coroutine. So you actually can end your coroutine by either reaching the end of your body or by calling co-return, and in that case you can end your thing. And there's also a co-yield, which is used for generators, which is also a use case for coroutines, where you return a value again and again. And for this, you have a yield value function inside of your promise type. And so the minimal promise type here is my dummy promise, which essentially just returns a no suspend from the initial suspend. Those are never called. This is also never called. And this one just returns my dummy type, which is an empty type. So the main point here is that I return the suspend never, so that I don't stop at the beginning, but actually start my coroutine. And now, as I said, the memory allocation comes from the heap, well, by calling operator new. However, you can overload the operator new for your promise type. And even if that is not what is actually allocated, that operator new will be used to allocate the memory. So if you want to allocate your memory somewhere special, then you can do that by providing your own operator new, and of course you should also provide the operator delete. And the point is, in many cases, the compiler will actually not use this operator new, but instead provide the memory on your stack of the initially calling function. And that happens if the compiler knows that the lifetime of your coroutines never outlives your initially calling function. And if the compiler can see that, then it will not allocate memory dynamically. And, well, in a lot of small embedded systems, it's actually fine to allocate memory in a startup phase. And this is what we do in our example, because we just immediately start all the coroutines, and that's essentially it. So now we have all coroutines started, we have all coroutine frames allocated before we enter our loop. And now inside of that loop, we never have any more memory allocations for the coroutine. However, that is not always the case, because it could actually be that you need to call some asynchronous function somewhere deep inside of your code. And then it's not easy to set it up at startup time. So in that case, you actually need to allocate memory somewhere deep inside your application. And well, now when actually get my coroutine frames destroyed? Well, to be honest, in my case, never. I actually leak them. Otherwise, they get destroyed either when you call the destroy function on them, or when you actually leave your coroutine body. So if it's not an endless loop, then you will actually, the coroutine frame will be destroyed whenever you leave your coroutine. And now here's actually a more useful handle, because that is some kind of III handle for your coroutine frame. And so this is part of the promise type, essentially. So what you do is you store the coroutine handle inside of your promise type, and now the destructor actually calls the destroy function on that. And now inside of the getReturn object, you can get at the coroutine handle calling this from promise static function of the coroutine handle and giving it a reference to yourself. And now this will actually give you the coroutine handle that you can store inside here. And now, first, you don't leak it. And second, you make it actually easy. So if you actually use that down here and you store that, now you have your coroutine handles, and they get cleaned up whenever you return from your function. And if your functions are all inline, the compiler knows that you actually destroy the coroutine handle in the destructor, and in that case, it can actually elide the memory allocation. So in this example, there will probably be no memory allocation using new. And I have already overdrawn my time for 5 minutes now. So just very short, you actually need to be careful about your coroutine handles, that you don't end up to use a coroutine handle that was already destroyed. And one of the cases is, well, in my case, everything is single-threaded. However, very often your loop is in a special thread. So inside of your await suspend, you actually start an asynchronous function. And it might happen that this asynchronous function immediately returns in the other thread. And then it might actually be that you end your coroutine, so now you actually, your own coroutine handle is already dangling. So you must be very careful that you don't access anything inside of that coroutine handle at this point in time. This one thing, and the other is, if you actually use that III type, and you also get out of your coroutine using coreturn, or because you are at the end of your coroutine, then you will actually get a double delete. Once by your III type, and once because you left your coroutine. So you really need to be careful about lifetime of your coroutine handle. And just as a very last slide, so stackless coroutines, they don't have the full stack. So whenever you need the actual call stack out of this, you don't have that anymore. If you need that, stackless coroutines are not for you. And then the other thing is it may allocate heap memory whenever you call a coroutine. So if you stack full coroutines, things are different because in stack full coroutines, you have the full stack for each coroutine, like for a thread. For a thread, you also have always a full stack. And this can typically really set up at startup time. However, it wastes a lot of RAM. And currently, they are not standardized. We have proposals, which is more or less based on boost context, but we don't have standardized anything. And that's it. I will still be available for questions, should you have some. But because I have overdrawn 10 minutes, I will probably stop now. Thank you. Okay.
Is the coroutine frame allocated at the compile time?
No. Kind of. It's never, at least so far, so sorry about that one. For now, it's never really allocated at compile time. However, at compile time, the compiler might decide not to, allocate using operator new, but to put it on the stack. So actually elide that memory allocation, but this can all only be done if the compiler really knows that the coroutine doesn't outlive this calling function.
And he wants to know if the code is available anywhere online.
Not yet, because I only finished it this morning, but I will make it available at on my own website, there will be a link to it.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. And everybody who is here, you can catch me in a break and ask questions there. Thank you.